it was, and what Siara and Jamaica who said, it takes cash to care.
Of course.
Every caring proposal they put to you, every PNM proposal that they object to and replace costs money.
Exactly.
But as they're offering you more and more, they're telling you that the treasury is empty. They're putting you on notice as they did in 1986. If they get into office, immediately there is no money to do what they offer to do. So I'm putting you on notice that the quality of your life, the quality of the lives that you enjoy in Trinidad and Tobago, especially those of you who depend on the government to stretch a hand out to you, you the ones who are least able to help yourselves and depend on the government for support, I am telling you, those who want to replace the PNM see that support as an unacceptable freeness. It's a freeness which will be stopped immediately if no money is in the treasury. Things you take for granted that the government must do, their policy is that that is freeness, encouraging you in worthlessness, encouraging you in laziness, and God alone knows we do have some worthless and lazy people in this country who deserve no assistance. But what about those who need that assistance and with the best will of the world can do no better unless the government extends a hand to them? I was at the parliament when a UNC member of parliament, one of our members of parliament, refer to CPAP workers as hogs feeding in the trough. Where is your empathy? Where is your sympathy for those who could least help themselves? Hogs? A member of parliament in this country refer to you all as hogs? And they want to run your country? Diamond Vale. This meeting is in Diamond Vale. This is a housing district built by a policy which they will have no part of. Their policy says that the government has no role to play in constructing and making houses available to you at subsidized prices. As far as they're concerned, that is encouraging freeness, worthlessness, and laziness. But I want to ask all of you here tonight, how many of you in this gathering tonight can purchase a home without government assistance in this economy, in this market? And when the government helps you in that way, it enriches you and your family. Because these Diamond Vale houses were sold for $17,000, and over time today they're worth over $1 million. That is how government policy helps you from there to there. And what are my concerns? As I said, I'm concerned about the PNM in this election. Right now, as I speak to you, there are about 10,000 houses in various stages of completion around the country. And if they are in office, I'm wondering whether they'll hand them out the same way they hand out the ones in Glencoe and on Angus Villas. In Glencoe, you would have heard me in the parliament not once but twice forcing John Humphrey to remove his family from NHA houses in Glencoe.
Yes.
And in Savannah Villas, there were two government ministers who were real estate agents in there. One owned two, and I had to put out one when I became Minister of Housing. And of course, the program will stop and die. And those of you who look to the state to carry out a housing policy, to give you the opportunity to live somewhere else. I don't know where you live. There are lovely houses in this district, but there are also people living cheek by jowl, wanting to move, to start a family, but you look at the papers and you can't even begin to go and visit a house because the cheapest house starts at $1 million. The government's housing program is to improve the quality of life of all of you, especially the children. And that, come May 25th, that dies with them. It's being said that they put no policy out. If they put no new policy out, you have to hold them by the old policy because they haven't changed that. It is what they have said they would do and what they have done you have to go by because no new policy has been advanced. And in so far as you know that there is no new policy, then on what basis do you make the change? Because Kamala has a new hairstyle. Because Duterte is now running for his third party. What was the basis? But I'll tell you something else too. We have to ensure that we separate the issues of the PNM as an institution and office holders functioning for the PNM. Because the campaign in 2010 seems to confuse the fact that you have to talk and deal with government business through an institution, not through an individual. An individual could walk away, could drop dead, but the institution is what you are supporting. We are the PNM from Eric Williams' days to now to whenever. And that's why whatever they say about us in the PNM, we support the PNM because the PNM represents that policy basis. What's that basis? It says multiracial solidarity, which means, as our anthem says, every creed and race, which also means whoever you are in this country, a piece of it belongs to you as PNM policy. It also says morality in public affairs, because you see, as you carry out the various programs and policies, whether you agree with them or not, and it's quite normal in any country for there to be disagreement with respect to the policy of the government, because there is never one policy which is the right one. There are options, and you may agree with the option or disagree with the option. But when the options are put into operations, government spends a lot of money. And there are always a lot of people wanting to get their hand on government money that they don't deserve. And such persons, they find them all the time. You find them all the time. When I joined the PNM in 1974, I heard about Lock Joint. Remember the Lock Joint project? And there were persons there who were supposed to have got their hands on government money that they didn't deserve, and they went to jail. And then when I was in government, in opposition, there was a UNC in office, you heard Piako Airport? And then when I was in cabinet, you heard about UDCOT? And today the police is talking to somebody in UDCOT, and a commissioner of inquiry has told you that managers in UDCOT must face criminal investigation because their role might not have been acceptable, and you people must know what happened there. So you agree with me that corruption is not an individual government thing or a party thing, it's a people thing, but you must deal with it in a certain way. And the way you deal with it is to ensure you have systems in place that prevent it. So when they come and tell you, vote for them because the PNM has corruption issues, I'm saying to you, those issues are issues that have to be dealt with, have been dealt with, and will be dealt with. And whether it's PNM, NAR, or UNC, the government of Trinidad and Tobago will always have to be aware that you protect yourself and the public interest from scoundrels who will thief your money. And when they thief your money, nobody must tell you, whether PNM or otherwise, that you should apologize or you should feel ashamed for hounding anybody out of office. Because if they do that, then you hound them out of office with no apology. Because they will do it time and time again, and they believe that you can do nothing about it. All over the world, I remember looking at the news in Bangladesh, famine in Bangladesh, and the world sent milk powder to Bangladesh, boatloads of it, and the government officials in Bangladesh were selling the powder milk back to Africa. People do these things. Not people do these things. Whether it's in Trinidad and Tobago, in Bangladesh, in Africa. In Africa, they sell and buy equipment from companies that don't exist. Make out checks to them. And when you go there, you discover that the company belongs to somebody in the government. These are issues that you have to take care of by having proper systems in place.